ثم دخل المصنف رحمه الله في بيان صفة الغسل.
And then the مصنف رحمه الله entered into explaining the characteristics of the غسل.
فقال رحمه الله: وأما صفة غسل النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم من الجنابة.
And then he said, and as for the description of the characteristics of the غسل of the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم from جنابة.
فكان يغسل فرجه أولا.
Then first he would begin by washing his private parts.
ثم يتوضأ وضوءا كاملا.
Then he would make a complete wudu.
ثم يحثي على رأسه ثلاثا يرويه بذلك.
Then he would pour the water upon his head three times.
ومعنى يرويه بذلك أن يصل الماء إلى أصول الشعر بحيث لا يكون الماء قليلا.
And he mentioned likewise that what he would do with the water is that he would make sure that it got to the roots of his hair. And not that he just used a little bit of water, but he used enough water that would get to the roots of his hair.
فقد روى البخاري رحمه الله في صحيحه من حديث عائشة رضي الله تعالى عنها قالت في وصف غسل النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم.
And indeed, Imam al-Bukhari narrated or collected in his Sahih the hadith of Aisha رضي الله عنها, where she said:
ثم يخلل بيده شعره حتى إذا ظن أنه قد أروى بشرته.
And she said when she was describing the ghusl of the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم that then he would run his fingers through his hair with the water until he was certain that the water had got to the roots of his hair.
أفاض عليه الماء ثلاث مرات ثم غسل سائر جسده.
And he would pour the water on his head three times and then he would wash the rest of his body.
ثم قال المصنف رحمه الله.
So then the author said رحمه الله.
ثم يفيض الماء على سائر جسده.
And then he would pour the water over the rest of his body.
ثم قال: ثم يغسل رجليه بمحل آخر.
And then he said that he would wash his feet in another place.
إذن إذا انتهى من غسله يغسل رجليه في مكان آخر. والصواب من أقوال أهل العلم أن هذا الفعل الأخير إنما هو عند الحاجة.
And the correct position the Sheikh mentioned concerning the statements of the people of knowledge concerning him moving and washing his feet in another place was that he did that whenever there was a need for him to do that.
مثل أن تكون في مكان فيه طين أو تراب فتخشى أن تتلوث رجلاك فتغسلهما في خارج المكان الذي اغتسلت فيه.
For instance that you made the ghusl in a place that where there was dirt, for instance, or there was mud or something like that, and you feared that you didn't want to dirty your feet, so you would move to another place, a clean place, and wash his feet in that place.
إذن الصواب من أقوال العلماء رحمهم الله في غسل الرجلين في مكان آخر بعد انتهاء الغسل إنما هو عند الحاجة لا عموما.
So therefore that which is correct from the statements of the scholars concerning washing one's feet in a place other than the place that he made ghusl in is that is done if there is a need for a person to do that and not done generally.
ثم قال المصنف رحمه الله تعالى: والفرض من هذا يعني الفرض الذي لا يصح الغسل شرعا إلا به.
And then the Sheikh mentioned that the fard or the compulsory thing that is from that, يعني the thing that a person's غسل will not be complete except by way of it.
غسل جميع البدن.
Is that a person washes the whole of his body. He must do this for his غسل to be sound.
وما تحت الشعور الخفيفة والثقيلة والكثيفة.
And that which is below the hair, that which is underneath the hair, whether that hair is thick or whether it is thin hair.
وهنا يجب أن يتنبه إلى أمر في الغسل وغيره وهي النية. ينوي رفع الحدث الذي كان فيه وهو الجنابة أو غيره من موجبات الغسل.
And another point that one must pay attention to, and that is the affair of the niyyah. And that is that when a person makes that ghusl, he makes the ghusl with the intention of raising from himself that state that he was in previously, whether it was janaba or other than janaba.